Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Seriously, You Have to Laugh. Great yarns and tall tales from the sporting fields, dressing rooms and commentary boxes of Australia. Written by Peter FitzSimons and read by David Tredinnick. Introduction. On the 30th of May 2016, I marked up 30 years since I began writing for the mighty Sydney Morning Herald. I love the paper, its people and its readers in equal measure, and have never lost the sense of privilege I had on that first day to be published in such a mighty journal. Over that time, I guess about 75% of my output has been in the sports pages, and within that realm, I have been frequently attracted to the funny yarns, the hilarious dressing room stories, the killer quotes that you just don't see coming. I have found that readers love that kind of stuff far more than accounts of who won what and why, and as I love writing that stuff more than the other, it is a happy coincidence. I'm indebted to many of those readers who have sent me such yarns over the years. It takes us all back to what sport was meant to be in the first place. Fun. I do hope you enjoy this collection of the funniest stuff I have written and gathered over the years. Peter FitzSimons, August 2016, Neutral Bay. Addressing the Balls. The following notice was prominently displayed at a popular suburban golf club. 1. Back straight, knees bent, feet shoulder-width apart. 2. Form a loose grip. 3. Keep your head down. 4. Avoid a quick backswing. 5. Stay out of the water. 6. Try not to hit anyone. 7. If you are taking too long, let others go ahead of you. 8. Don't stand directly in front of others. 9. Quiet, please, while others are preparing. 10. Don't take extra strokes. Well done. Now, flush the urinal, wash your hands, go outside and tee off. Taking pains. And then, of course, there is the story of the famed hard man of rugby league in the 1960s, Kevin Ryan. One time, while playing a home game for St George at Cogra Oval against the Manly Sea Eagles, Ryan executed such a devastating tackle against the Manly prop that he dislocated his shoulder and knocked the prop into the middle of next week. Both men were rushed straight to St George Hospital, where a young doctor tried to put Ryan's shoulder back in. Now, although not usually a man to even grimace when in pain, this action by the young doctor was so agonising that the surprised Ryan did indeed let out a loud cry. Seeing an opportunity to take down a peg or two, this esteemed representative of the very footballing breed she had never warmed to, matron scolded him, "Why, Mr. Ryan, that is not necessary. I have just come from delivering Mrs. Smithers' baby in the next ward, and she didn't make half as much noise."
"Really?" growled Ryan in reply. "Let's see what kind of noise she'd make if they tried to put the baby back in."
Tie this on. At the Rugby World Cup of 2011, an Englishman, a Scotsman, an Irishman, a Welshman, a Gurkha, a Latvian, a Turk, an Aussie, a German, a Yank, an Egyptian, a Japanese, a Mexican, a Spaniard, a Russian, a Pole, a Lithuanian, a Jordanian, a Kiwi, a Swede, a Finn, an Israeli, a Romanian, a Bulgarian, a Serb, a Swiss, a Greek, a Singaporean, an Italian, a Norwegian, an Argentinian, a Libyan, a Pakistani, an Indian, a Chinese, a Macedonian, a Ukrainian, and an African, all turned up together at a Swish Wellington nightclub.
"Sorry," the bouncer says, glaring at them balefully. "I can't let you in without a tie."
Bait and switch. The last time the Pope was in Australia, he found himself beside a river in the Northern Territory when a sudden commotion on the far shore attracted his attention. Holy Mary! Right there,
in the jaws of a massive crocodile, is a man wearing an all-black jersey desperately struggling to get free. Suddenly, three blokes wearing wallaby jerseys roar into view on a speedboat. The first bloke fires a harpoon into the croc's ribs, while the other two reach over and pull the kiwi from the river before, using long clubs, they beat the croc to death. They are bundling the bleeding, semi-conscious man into the speedboat when... what the... they notice someone. Bugger me. It is a bloke on the bank wearing a small white beanie. He calls out to them in this thick accent.
I had heard that there was a racist, xenophobic divide between Australia and New Zealand. But now I have seen with my own eyes that this is not true. I can see that your societies are true examples of racial harmony and could serve as a model that other nations could follow.
With which he blessed them and drove off in a cloud of dust. As he departs, the harpoonist turns to the other Aussies and asks,
"Who the bloody hell was that?"
"That," one answered, "was His Holiness the Pope. He is in direct contact with God."
"Well," the harpoonist sagely replies, "he knows F all about croc hunting. Now, will this bait still do, or do we need to get another one?"
King of the Quickie. Wayne Carey and Mark Bickley are enjoying a lunch at a fancy West Lakes restaurant. The waitress approaches their table to take their order. She's young and very attractive. She asks Bickley what he wants and he replies,
"I'll have the heart-healthy salad."
"Very good, sir," she says. Turning to Carey, she asks, "And what do you want, Wayne?" Carey answers,
"How about a quickie?"
Taken aback, the waitress slaps him and says, "I'm shocked and disappointed in you. I thought you were on the straight and narrow and committed to high principles and morality, not like last year." With that, the waitress departs in a huff. In the stunned silence that follows, Bickley leans over to Carey and says,
"Actually, Wayne, I believe that's pronounced quiche."
I feel obliged to pass on to you the results of a recent poll in Melbourne which asked 1,000 women if they would ever sleep with Wayne Carey. 72% replied, "Never again." Shortly after the Wayne Carey blow-up in 2002, a North Melbourne supporter wrote to The Age, in misery, "This has been the worst year of my life. First 9/11, and now this."
Best's dry run. The great George Best was once asked why he left Manchester United in the early 70s to go to play in the ill-fated American Soccer League.
"Because," Best replied, "I was walking along King's Road in Chelsea one day, and a London bus went past with the advertisement, 'Drink Canada Dry.' So I did."
After Best's fall from grace in the 70s, he played briefly for various no-name clubs in England and Scotland and was given a final last chance in America with the Tampa Bay Rowdies or some such. At the time, he was still escorting a former Miss World. On a rare weekend off, the couple went to Las Vegas, where George had a big win at the tables. A small recompense for all the money he'd previously lost, but anyway... Back in his room, he ordered a nightcap of French champagne and some caviar. The room service waiter, a fellow native of Belfast, arrived to see George was sitting on the bed counting a huge pile of $100 and $1,000 notes as his partner emerged from the bathroom in a slinky negligee. The waiter looked at the money, the girl, the champagne and caviar and said,
"Tell me this, George. Just... where exactly did it all start to go wrong for you?"
Woods Wonder. Stevie Wonder and Tiger Woods are in a bar. Stevie asks Tiger how his golf is going. Tiger replies,
"I've had some problems with my swing, but I think it's okay now."
Stevie says,
"I always find that when my swing goes wrong, I need to stop playing for a while and not think about it."
Tiger says,
You play golf?
Stevie says,
Yes, I've been playing for years.
Tiger says, But you're blind. How can you play golf if you can't see? Stevie Wonder replies,
Well, I get my caddy to stand in the middle of the fairway and call to me. I listen for the sound of his voice and play the ball towards him.
But how do you putt? Asks Tiger.
Well, says Stevie, I get my caddy to lean down in front of the hole and call to me with his head on the ground, and I just play the ball towards his voice.
Tiger asks, What's your handicap? Stevie says,
Well, actually, I'm a scratch golfer.
Tiger, incredulous, says to Stevie, We've got to play a round sometime. Wonder replies,
Well, people don't take me seriously, so I only play for money and never play for less than $10,000 a hole. Not a problem.
Woods thinks about it and says, Okay, I'm game for that. $10,000 a hole is fine with me. When would you like to play? Stevie says,
Pick a night.
7 Easy Steps. With the ski season upon us, I've been sent the following bits of training advice for those getting ready to hit the slopes. 1. Visit local butcher and pay $30 to sit in the walk-in freezer for 30 minutes. Afterwards, burn two $50 bills to warm up. 2. Throw away a $100 bill. Now. 3. Find the nearest ice rink and walk across the ice 20 times in your ski boots carrying 2 pairs of skis, accessory bag and poles. Pretend you are looking for your car. Sporadically drop things. 4. Place a small but angular pebble in your shoes, line them with crushed ice and then tighten a C-clamp around your toes. 5. Go to McDonald's and insist on paying $8.50 for a hamburger. Be sure you're in the longest line. 6. Dress up in as many clothes as you can and then proceed to take them off because you have to go to the bathroom. 7. Slam your thumb in a car door. Don't go see a doctor.
That hurts. The following exchange took place on ABC Radio during the second of the one-day internationals between Australia and the West Indies, after the Australian vice-captain took a fearful ball to the groin. Commentator 1, concerned.
Michael Clark's in a lot of pain. The West Indies wicketkeeper is offering some sympathy.
Commentator 2.
Ricky Ponting is wandering down to see how his vice-captain is.
Commentator 1, indignant tone.
Ricky's just tapped Clarky on the bum with his bat.
Commentator 2.
Probably knocking them back out.
Masochism training. After last week's rant on things one could do to prepare for the skiing season, join the longest queue at McDonald's and finally get to pay an exorbitant price for a hamburger, a reader suggests how to prepare to play rugby union. 1. Find large pool of mud. Dive into it. 2. Find large friend. Have him beat you up. 3. Walk to first floor window. Jump out. 4. Buy a whistle. Have a friend blow it at you constantly for 80 minutes. 5. Have a friend practice goal kicking while you stand around watching until your nose bleeds.
Remembering Richie. A few favourite Benno moments. Bruce Reid was coming out to bat, with Australia still a few runs short of victory in a one-day match. Richie, dry as the nullarbor.
Well, Bruce Reid is not the worst batsman there is at international level, but those who are worse would not need to hire the Maya Music Bowl to hold a convention.
Richie Benno, as dry as his favourite martini, when New South Wales batsman Corey Richards was being treated for an injury high on his leg in a match against South Australia.
It's either a groin or a hamstring. Don't know which is worse. It's been so long since I've pulled either.
Co-commentator.
He's been struggling with tennis elbow.
Richie, in his driest tone.
Now, what's a nice boy like that doing with tennis elbow?
That's a handy contribution. Jim Muir recently took his 9-year-old daughter Lucy to see an A-League match. The referee had made some unpopular decisions and, of course, the chant went up from the crowd that, "The referee's a wanker, the referee's a wanker." It was at this point that Lucy turned to her father and asked the obvious question, "What's a wanker, Dad?" Her question, put loudly in the voice of one whose very innocence penetrated the atmosphere all around, reduced the fans close by to a stunned silence. How was Dad going to answer this? They leaned forward as each second struck like thunder, and our man Jim went through a variety of possible answers before rejecting each one. And then an angel appeared, in the form of a large Scotsman, positioned just 2 seats away.
"A wanker," he said, "is a man who prefers his own company."
Rough End. A bodybuilder appeared on Bert Newton's Family Feud and was asked to name a vegetable starting with P. His answer was pineapple. But better still, apparently in the early 90s, in an earlier incarnation of Family Feud, a fellow called Graham was asked to name a food that makes a noise when you eat it. "Baked beans," he replied confidently.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.